So first of all, I think I would like to acknowledge all the activists who got the award. I think it's admirable that you all are in the field doing the work. Rather, you walk the talk, and I just do the talking normally. So salute to all the activists, and then great to hear all of them, you know, acknowledging and appreciating Balipara Foundation for the award. But rather, I would like to you know, acknowledge further and highlight the people behind the Balipara Foundation. That's Ranjit and Mrs. Ranjit. Please give them big hand. And then we have 85 years old mother who is here to remember and honor her late husband. Please give her, it's a bit late for her also, but she's here to support and solidarity with all of us. And then I would like to acknowledge Dilip and the staff of the Balipara Foundation and all the volunteers for making this event a success. As you can see, I'm not an expert on this field, so I'm trying to get my time, pass my time, so that I become more a cheerleader than and a speaker that is expected this evening, because I've been hearing from all of you. I was very, very impressed about when you talk about botany and flowers and about zoo and animals, things like that. I don't have much knowledge, but I learned a great deal, but definitely appreciate a lot. Now, I think the host rightly said I should be speaking very short, because all the speakers have spoken all the topics, there's nothing left to say. Said, and being the last speaker, the advantage is that you can make your speech short, and then we all can go for a dinner, which I'm sure you all were tempted to go after this event. Now, if you look at globally, because I come from law background, a bit of a political background, there is decline of internationalism and decline of liberalism, which we saw the rise of internationalism and liberalism in late 80s and 90s. And on those two, rise of internationalism and liberalism, we rode the wave for human rights, for democracy, for environmental matters. But now there's a challenge to internationalism. There is rise of nationalism that you can see from America to Europe to Asia. And then there is rise of extremism. Also, because you can see IS and Boko Haram and the militant Buddhists in Burma, you can clearly see in a violent form of extremism. Now, in this context, we are entering a new world, a very challenging, complex, and conflict-oriented world. Now, many experts also say the 21st century will be a century of Asia, which we all welcome, because there will be economic growth in Asia, and Asia will dominate the 21st century. But at the same time, there is armed race going on, and if you, I'm sure from some accounts, the largest number of arms are bought in Asia. So with Asia dominating the world, arms race is also dominating Asia, and countries are preparing for war. And what are the likely scenario, what might be the cause for this kind of conflict in this part of the world and globally? Hence, I've been hearing that World Bank said the Earth can sustain 7 billion people. Unfortunately, this year, we will be reaching 8 billion people, which means we have 1 billion people more than the Earth can sustain. Now, for 1 billion people extra, you don't have forests or the land or the water to sustain them. Hence, many experts also say that wars were fought over land during the colonial era. Nowadays, wars are fought over oil and petrol. That's why there is crisis in Venezuela, there is crisis in Nigeria, there is crisis in Iraq, because these countries are rich in oil. Soon, there will be war over water because of the shortage of water. In that sense, even though the conference is about to stay in Himalaya, but the whole of Himalaya is very, very important for the whole world. In fact, the whole of Himalaya is as fragile and as important as the rainforest of Latin America, but not much recognition is given. And hence, to have this Balipara Foundation and the Natural Economics Forum to discuss about the preservation of elephant and the tiger and all the animals and botany and local community and villages and rural future are very, very important. Hence, preservation and conservation of Himalaya is very, very important. Now, as a Tibetan, I must say, on top of Himalaya sits Tibet. Now, many experts say Tibet is the third pole, because after Antarctica and Arctic, Tibet has the third highest reserve of ice. The difference is that in Antarctica and Arctic, when they melt, it goes to ocean. But when the ice of Tibet melt, it forms rivers. And 10 major rivers of Asia flow from Tibet. Indus River, the cradle of Chinese civilization. India is called India after Indus River, but it starts from Tibet. Satluj River, which flows from Tibet to Jammu and Kashmir to Pakistan, flows from Tibet. And lifeline of Assam and Northeast and Bangladesh, Brahmaputra, flows from Tibet. And some of the representatives are here from ASEAN countries. You name Salween River, Mekong River, Irrawaddy River, which are also lifeline for ASEAN countries, flow from Tibet. Yangtze River in China, and Yellow River, the cradle of Chinese civilization, also flow from Tibet. Hence, Tibet is the water tower of Asia, and 1.4 billion people, downstream people, depend and survive on rivers starting from Tibet. Hence, Tibet is very, very important for not just the Himalayan region, for East, Southeast Asia, for South Asia and whole of Asia as well. Now, the problems are as follows. Some scientists have said the climate in South America are directly affected by the jet stream over Tibet. A scientist in Quebec has said whether the winter of Canada will be warm or cold is affected by the climate or the jet stream over Tibet. In fact, a scientist from California has said that if you want to understand global warming or climate change, you must understand the Tibetan plateau. Till then, it won't be complete. But the problem is, till year 2000, in the last 100 years, 50% of Tibetan glaciers have melted and disappeared. According to NASA, by 2100, of the remaining 46,000 glaciers we have, you know, Tibet is very rich in mountains. 100 highest mountains of the world are in Tibet. Now, of the remaining 46,000 glaciers that we have now, by 2100, minimally one-third and up to two-thirds of these glaciers will disappear. If two-thirds of glaciers disappear, what will happen to 1.4 billion people who are dependent on fresh water flowing from Tibet? Hence, there is a crisis in the making. It's looming large. So that way, it's very important we talk about preservation and conservation of flora and fauna of the Himalayan belt, but it's equally important. How do we handle the water tower of Asia, that's Tibet? Because there's been a recent news that Chinese government is planning to divert Brahmaputra River all the way to Xinjiang. If that happens, what will happen to the lifeline of Northeast Assam and Bangladesh? Hence, there is a crisis in making. Now, what's happening is that not just the rivers being diverted, not just glaciers being melted, partly because of the global warming, partly because of the urbanization of Tibet, industrialization of Tibet, deforestation that is taking place in Tibet. Because if there is 1 degree of temperature rise in the rest of the world, it's 2 degrees on the Tibetan plateau because it's so fragile and so delicate. I'm saying all these things not because I'm a Tibetan. I'm rather reiterating what the Chinese environmentalists and scientists have been saying Given the fragile nature of Tibetan plateau, we all have to preserve and conserve it in the form of Third Pole National Park. This is the proposal offered by Chinese environmentalist scientists. And Chinese government ought to listen to Chinese environmentalist scientists, not to me. Because Tibet is vital for the rest of the world. Now, because of industrialization, because of deforestation, because of urbanization of Tibet, the temperature in Tibet is rising very fast, and not just the 46,000 glaciers are melting rapidly, which might disappear one-third or two-third by 2100, then there'll be a major crisis in the whole world. The problem is also China has 19% of the world population, but only 12% of fresh water, which means 7%, remaining 7% of 400 million Chinese are already facing water crisis. And the situation in Bangladesh or ASEAN or India is worse than China. Now, what will happen if water scarcity happens? That's one crisis. Now, with the rise of temperature globally and on the Tibetan plateau, not only glaciers are melting fast, but also it's melting or defrosting the permafrost. Permafrost, we all might know, in a simple form, which means the soil freezes. It's so cold, it freezes, right? But what it does is it holds the carbon dioxide underneath that soil and methane underneath that soil. Now, Tibetan plateau, half of Tibetan plateau, up to 1.6 million square kilometers of land, is permafrost. And underneath it, there are 12,000 million tons of carbon dioxide. An equal number, around 12,000 million tons of methane. Now imagine, with the global warming and urbanization, industrialization of Tibet, permafrost melts, which is as deep as 1 meter to 30 meters. The 1 meter can melt very fast. Once it opens up, it will release all the carbon dioxide. And methane is two or three times more stronger than carbon dioxide. If all this is released in the air of the earth, you can clearly see a danger. Increasing the global warming, affecting ozone layer, and polluting, rather, the whole planet, especially Asia. So in that sense, Tibet is vital that we ought to preserve and protect and conserve Tibetan plateau. So I just want to say two points. But traditionally, Tibetans as Buddhists, we have managed and maintained the Tibetan plateau and shared our water resources with all our neighboring countries. Nowadays, we drink water in bottles, right? You have to buy. So had Tibetans been selling our water for centuries, I think we would have been the richest country in the whole world. But part of this practice of sharing water comes from our Buddhist tradition or Buddhist values. As we all know, Buddha was an environmentalist in the sense that he was born under a tree. He attained enlightenment under a tree. He gave his first teaching to 7 followers under a tree. So there's a symbolism behind it. And as a Buddha, when he taught about the human being, he talked also about interdependence. Interdependence between human being and nature. For example, you know, this is a dialectic discourse. When you ask someone as a Buddhist, who are you? And someone asks you, who are you? If you have to point and define I, the you, so normally if you are asked, who are you? You will say, who is you, rather? Then you will point somewhere in your body and say, this is me. But that's your chest. If you say, this is me, that's your head. If you say, this whole body is you, then the Buddhist dialectic discourse will say, if this body is you, you can't live without air that you breathe. You can't live water, which in fact is 90% of your body. You can't live without food. So you are dependent or interdependent with nature as well. So when you define you as an individual, nature is part of you. Hence, that's the Buddhist value we have. And hence, you know, I'm sure in India and rest of the world, you see Buddhist prayer flags everywhere. And it has 5 elements: earth, water, sky, air. because we believe nature is part of humanity and we are dependent on nature as much as we live in this earth. Hence, this Buddhist notion has helped us preserve and protect the Tibetan plateau for many centuries. And hence, if you don't want to see water crisis, if you don't want to see global warming, it's very important that we respect the fragile nature of Himalaya, an important aspect of Himalaya and the Tibetan plateau. So with that, I will end my short speech because everybody is looking at their watches and thinking, when is the time to go for sumptuous dinner? So I don't want to spoil your mood, but again, I want to thank really Balipara Foundation for inviting me here and by honoring me here. I feel it's a great privilege to be here. In fact, yesterday and today, conflicted with a couple of my dates, my friend and Chief Minister, Honorable Chief Minister of Arunachal Pradesh was visiting Dharamsala. Instead of hosting him, I came here. And yesterday also, His Holiness Dalai Lama was inaugurating a monastic school. Now, as per protocol, I'm mandated to be next to His Holiness Dalai Lama to be there. But then I came here, not as an expert. As you can see, I don't know much about, you know, nature and conservation and preservation, except I have a diploma from WWF on environmental law, which is 6 months course. I don't know much about, but I came here to admire all the activists who got awards and all those activists in the field, and I've come here to cheer all of you and continue your good work, particularly the Balipara Foundation. Thank you very much.